Hello, welcome to the Art of Renovation Live. I'm your host, Paul Foster from Contact Renovations and Custom Homes. This week, we're going to talk about basement renovation tips, and it'll be a bit different than our usual episode where I have a specific contractor or vendor on the show to talk about their trade or topic. This week, we're going to do it basically on my own because there's so much to talk about in basement developments and renovations. But I will have a couple people chime in throughout the show about their specific tasks. If I see them following, I'll just have them, I'll bring them onto the show. We'll talk about their topic for a bit. So, renovations, you know, it's always, there's many different ways to do any kind of reno, but the basement is kind of its own type of a project because we're taking something that is potentially unfinished if you have a newer home, or have to renovate what was previously developed by someone else in a previous time frame for code compliance and standards and whatnot. So like any project, the main point is to start with a good design. So on that note, the design this week will be our giveaway item. So there you go. The giveaway item this week would be I will do up, or my team will do up, a floor plan for a basement development. It's worth about $1,000. Typically that would include then a trip to site to confirm as-built dimensions and all that stuff, and then we do the layout for you. It does not include interior design and the HVAC schematics and all those details and engineering, but you would get a floor plan out of it. So to be entered into the draw, you have to just comment the answer to this question. Do you need a development permit to renovate your basement? So there you go. If you know the answer, enter it in the comment. I just want to say, I'm sorry, but it's not transferable. So if you win the free design, you can't go and offer it to your neighbor or whatever it is. It's, if you're, you know, part of the show today and you enter and you win, fantastic. I'll come and do, get your floor plan done for your basement renovation at no charge. Anyhow, so on that note, I would say that, yeah, it's very important that your design is the starting point to your basement development. And what you don't want to do is on the fly by be figuring out how you're going to lay out the basement or decide you want to make changes along the way, because changes can be expensive, they cause delays, so it's always best to have a good plan right off the get-go. Okay, so there you go. Now we'll move on more into the different topics here that I think are important, and the options and all that kind of stuff. So I guess let's talk first of all, not really an optional item, permits. Do you need a permit for your project? It's kind of a not necessarily black and white answer. So if you have an unfinished basement currently, yes, you will need a development permit to develop that into usable space. It's change of use because it's going from unused space to finished space. So you need a development permit. You will also need a building permit. And in conjunction with that, you will also need then the usual things, electrical permits, plumbing, HVAC, etc. So the answer to the skill testing question is, do you need a permit for a basement development? Yes, you do if it's currently undeveloped. If you have a finished basement, but it was done years ago, you're in a 50s bungalow or whatever it is, and you want to basically gut and renovate that basement, if the floor plan changes significantly, the city's going to want to see a development permit applied for, and we will need the other permits in conjunction with that, so the building permit and the safety codes, all that kind of stuff along the way. So the permitting, you know, it's one of those things. It's not a lot of fun to go through it, but it's an important part of making sure you get the job done right, because along the way are the inspections. They make sure it's safe, it adheres to code, and realistically it's the city and the province's way of making sure that what you get done is done safely and properly. So as much as it's a hassle, it's worth doing it. If your contractor tries talking you out of it, that's a big red flag. And as a homeowner, you are able to pull your own permits as well. It might be a little bit more of an arduous task for you than someone who's experienced, but I can also say the city will be far more cooperative working with you as a homeowner than us as contractors at times. I shouldn't say that, you know, carte blanche, but in any case. So if your basement has a wet bar, or you're putting a kitchenette in there, you can expect right away a big red flag on your application, because the city's going to wonder if that is potentially going to be a secondary suite. So you have to be very careful about how your basement development, your renovation, what that floor plan looks like, what it incorporates. If you decide to leave the look of a wet bar or kitchenette out of your plan and go apply for your permit, but then when the inspector is back for final, or any of the other inspectors, whether for plumbing, electrical rough-ins, HVAC rough-ins, if they see a rough-in for a kitchenette, then they're going to flag it. But a worst-case scenario is that none of those specific inspectors notice it, and just on building final, someone goes, what? There's a kitchen in here. Your plan didn't show a kitchen. You now have a major problem. So it's one of those things to, when you apply for the permit, be prepared for a delay in processing of your application if you have a wet bar or a kitchenette in there. And if you don't intend it to be used as a secondary suite, it's just for your family to have your theater and your popcorn area or whatever it is. Sometimes in the past, the city would accept a letter from the homeowner stating that on record, this is not to be used as a secondary suite. This is for my, you know, use as a single family home for my family. So there. So be aware of that. So anyhow, so permitting, for the most part, yes, you'll need a permit. Maybe not development, but for sure building if it's starting from scratch. If you happen to have a finished basement that we're redoing or adding to in some way, you'll want to make sure that you have on someone previously had pulled the right permits to develop the space. Because we have recently been in a home where we're asked to put a fireplace area into the basement. And when we went to pull our electrical permit, the city said, well, how can you pull an electrical permit? Because there's no development permit showing a finished basement. So it actually opened up a huge can of worms and ended up being this client. We had to, on behalf of the client, apply retroactively for the development permit and building permit for that already finished basement, which, you know, the fees are doubled to do that by the city. And then if the inspector wants walls open to inspect wiring and plumbing, then you have to comply. So, you know, if you're buying a home and the basement's developed, make sure that you have proof that permitting was pulled and inspections completed. Anyhow, we'll move on from the exciting world of permits and we'll get into framing considerations. So look, if you bought a house and it was a new build and the builder has the basement frost walls done, so the wall, they have exterior walls framed and there's insulation and poly down there, you can bet your bottom dollar that the builder did it as inexpensively as possible to meet code minimum requirements. Okay, it's just the way it is, right? They have to just pass an occupancy inspection, and to do that they need that basement frost wall done. So often no money goes into that, and it becomes someone's headache later when it's time to develop a space. Okay, so that's not the right picture here. Bear with me, I'll just try to find the shot I'm looking for here that will show generally what to expect when you're getting your home, a new home from the builder. Bear with me as I just rifle through here. So generally you'll see something like this where you're gonna have, you know, your frost walls should be done. Sometimes you'll see that they framed them with steel stud framing, could be 2x4 wall framing, could be 2x6. Just depends on the age of your home, okay? So now the issue to think about with the framing, so when you're designing your new space, my thoughts and beliefs are always to do it right, build the bones properly. So well-framed, well-insulated, like all that, the stuff that's not pretty, all that infrastructure, do it right, because you can't go back later and insulate a finished basement without tearing it all apart again. So I would say do that, do these building block stages properly, and maybe you go on a less expensive floor product, and then in 2 years you can upgrade that later. So anyway, so often you'll see these frost walls done at minimum 24 inch spacing. Not necessarily an issue, depending on how you plan to use the space. So if you know you're going to have a whole bunch of wall-mounted cabinets there, or shelving, or you're going to put your big TV and make kind of a theater zone, you probably want to make sure that you brace up that wall so it can take some load hung off of it, right? So that's one thing to consider when it comes to your framing. You know, the other thing would be, how did they finish up in the rim joist? So the best way to finish is with spray foam. It fully insulates it, it seals it all, it then works in conjunction with your vapor barrier. It's the best way to finish the space, but yeah, it's a bit extra to have them come in and spray foam. We always include it in what we do because we believe it's the right way to do it. But there are other ways to do it. You can stuff it with bad insulation. You can staple and tape poly up into all the cavities, but generally it doesn't work well or nearly as well as spray foam might. So yeah, so anyways, when it comes to insulating your basement, you know, you have options as far as how to do the insulation. If you're in an older home and you want us to re-renovate the basement and you don't want to take your frost walls out, there's a good chance you're going to have a far lower wall thickness and lower R value in your wall. So we generally would recommend that you upgrade that to get more insulation in the wall because the space will feel warmer and perform better. Yes, it's a cost now, but you'll get that return on your investment as far as comfort goes and maybe even on the heating cost side of things. Okay, so it's just a matter of how you're going to insulate it. You know, you can use fiberglass insulation like you see here. We can get into using some of the rock wool products that generally do perform far better. They're more moisture resistant, they're flame resistant. Here's an idea of that product. That's a rock wool product. So another option then, as we move on out of the framing considerations, now becomes into your insulation. We talked about the frost wall. How are you going to deal with sound in your home? We always recommend some sound insulation in the ceilings. It's something that'll help to stop the pounding noises you'll hear from people walking around upstairs. It also then, if you have a theater downstairs or it's a kid's play area, whatever it is, then you don't get so much sound transmitting upstairs. Around the bedrooms, we always like to insulate as well to help give someone a restful space. Maybe around the bathrooms, so you don't have to hear what's happening in the bathroom when you're trying to rest, whatever that might be, right? So sound insulation is always a good option. It doesn't add a ton of cost, and there's different ways we can approach it. Whether you add a res channel, and that basically is a little product bar you hang onto the ceiling before you attach onto the floor joist before you attach your drywall, and that basically what it does is take the vibration away from your finished drywall so that less sound is transferred through that product. So so there you go. So insulation, it's something to consider. There used to be an issue where you couldn't put any water lines on an outside wall, and that generally was the case and still can be depending on what you're putting in there. But now with spray foam, we can insulate some exterior wall cavities, so you could still have some plumbing lines in them. So that eliminates the need to build out what we call pony walls in front of an exterior wall to house plumbing lines. So it's something to consider. So when you're talking to your contractor about your basement and how you're going to finish it and what you're using for insulation, this opens up a few more options for your layout and will save you some floor space of not having to build out walls to accommodate the plumbing. Okay. Electrical consideration. So, coincidentally, I see Apex Electrical just joined this call here, or the tuned in. So we'll probably pull Neil in a minute here and talk a bit about electrical. So within the electrical component of things, there's some considerations to make, right? When it comes down to receptacles themselves, power. So when you get that basement from your builder, frost walls are framed in, all that kind of stuff, there's not going to be enough electrical in those perimeter walls to facilitate a finished space. So you have to understand that we're going to need to basically pull out the insulation from the finished frost wall and take the poly off so that we can ultimately go through there and add electrical. So here's a basement we got from that was builder finished to this point. And you can see in that wall, there's insulation, vapor barrier, there's no plug. So here it is after the fact. You can see now we've got a bunch of plugs down there. Well, to get them there, the insulation's got to come out, right? So understand that electrically speaking, you'll have to do some electrical upgrades in the walls that are, partially finished already. Also, so now we're going to have a, receptacle, 6 feet from every corner, 10 foot onwards from there. You know what? Why don't we let's see if I can get Neil on the show. And bear with me for a second here. Let's see if I can pull him in here. We'll get him to explain it. Give him a sec to come on. Neil.
How you doing, Paul?
Hey, doing good.
Good, good.
Thanks for popping in.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me. It's good to be back on.
Right on. Good, good. Yeah, so we're just talking about basement renovations and developments and electrical considerations. So, you know, I've mentioned how in your frost walls, which are done by the builder, we're going to have to rewire them anyways to get more receptacles in there. And I guess it depends too. If you have aluminum framed or steel framed walls, the cost is a bit higher, electrically speaking, because of how you have to run your wire through that. Is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely. So usually when it comes to, if you're doing aluminum framing, all this comes down to is just protection of the wire. Understandably, with aluminum frames, you're going to have sharper edges. So that would change the wire that you have to pull. It'd be more of a BX style cable. And just making sure everything is protected. It has an aluminum coat around the wire. Whereas if it was in a wood frame, which is kind of standard, you drill your holes, you run Lumex, where you don't need to have that, thick protective coating around the wire because there's no sharp edges, really.
Right. Yeah, it makes total sense. So if you have steel framed walls, be prepared for your electrical costs to be a little bit higher when we come in to quote that, because there's some extra steps that are required there. Let's talk a bit about pot lighting in a basement, and I guess in general. So we do a lot of LED panel lights now, which is basically an LED pot light, and they provide far more light. The operating cost is way less, but they're, to install multiple LED panel lights or pot lights will cost far more than just putting one centralized box in the room and one light fixture. Right. So,
yeah, absolutely. I think it's one of the biggest components in all renovations, I think, is lighting. It's easy to kind of short yourself on it, but then it's one of those things down the road, you're probably going to wish that you change the lighting grid instead of just having a central kind of a light that doesn't really give too much, light, I guess. So when you're doing a reno, the biggest thing to sit back and really think about is the layout of the pot lights. And like you said, LEDs, they are going to be more expensive, but in the long run, they're going to last way longer. They're going to give off way better light. And there's so many different styles and types of pot lights now. It's really cool to kind of dive into that area of electrical.
Yeah, absolutely. I would agree. And really, like, the way that you light your basement can really be a game changer as far as, does it feel dark down there? Do you have task lighting? Do you have kind of ambient lighting, whatnot? So that's a consideration to take. So when you're getting your quotes on your basement development, you have to really look at how the wiring's been done, how the switching's done. Do you have three-way switches so it's easy to turn lights off as you enter and exit rooms? What kind of lighting grid do you have and whatnot, right? So it's really important to plan your lighting so that it's like the insulation side of things. If you don't like how your basement's lit after you've done the reno, you've got a problem.
Yeah.
Now you've got to open things back up again.
It's challenging to add switch legs afterwards. You want to make sure you really think about how things are switched, where they're being switched from. Just convenience of your lighting grid and layout makes such a difference at the end of the renovation.
Absolutely. One more thing to consider too is where you plan to mount your TV. And how we're going to address that. So, I mean, we use what we call raceways quite often. And I guess maybe Neil, you can explain that a bit. I'm going to dig around here for a photo to help show in the background.
Yeah, for sure. So these are probably one of the coolest features of these, most of our renovations. The client usually decides where they want their TV. You know, they'll have a fireplace underneath it or however you kind of want to design it. But the raceways are cool because we set them behind the walls. Where, there you go, it's a great picture. So you can see where the fireplace would go. The top of the raceway is going to where you're going to have your recessed TV box. So you're going to have one slot where you can feed all your HDMI cables in. You got power up there. And then on the other end is where you're going to have your kind of central hub station with your Xbox, all your Shaw or Telus kind of components. So it hides all the cables. It makes it look a really clean look. And yeah, there's a nice little finished look to it. So
yeah, there's the aftershot. So you can see now when you hang your TV up, everything's tight behind the TV. There's a raceway down to that bottom left corner where they can have a little cabinet if they want to put their PVR, their Apple TV, their PlayStation, whatever it is. All the wires are concealed and everything looks nice and clean. Great. Well, I think for now, like, what else should we talk about that's a good option? Heated tile floors. Okay, look, heated floors in general. If you are putting a bathroom in your basement, which most basements are going to have, and you're planning to put tile on your floor, please heat that tile. It's going to add $1,000, $1,200, whatever it is, to the cost of the job, but it's going to be so much more comfortable than walking out of your shower or getting off the toilet, whatever it is you're doing in there, and having cold feet. So we always recommend heating basement floor tile. And it's one of those things where, you know, it can be worth the expense. It just depends on what matters to you, or you put a raised subfloor into, I guess, or deal with
something, right? Like, yeah. It's, you need something, like you said, just the concrete in your basement. You know, I've been on jobs where they want it done afterwards, and it just makes it more challenging, right? You're pulling up tile, you're doing things twice. So it's one of those things, just, you want to commit to kind of, you know, a little bit deeper of a cost, but if you decide to do, you want to do it later, it's going to be triple the cost at the end of it, right? So just understanding 100%, that's what it comes down to, right? And just doing everything right the first time.
Some of the stuff you can't do afterwards, right? Yeah. So in this picture I'm showing now, this is an IKEA God Morgan vanity. It's got a heated tile floor. It's got an IKEA wall storage unit for their linen. Like, these are not expensive components. Sure, they put the extra $1,000 into the floor heat. We also have an under cabinet light in this image, which is on a motion sensor. So you walk into this bathroom at night, it triggers the motion. A little light comes on underneath the vanity. No need to hit the light switch. It's on a timer. It's a great little touch. It adds like $500, right? So I would say do that kind of stuff now. And then later you can upgrade your vanity later without having to redo the infrastructure, right? Or, you know, live with the one piece acrylic top for now. And then later on you can upgrade it to quartz or granite or whatever you want. Right.
So totally.
Anyways, those are kind of things I think electrically speaking that are important to consider. Thanks Neil for popping in. I appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely, Paul. Anytime. Good to be back on. Yeah, we'll get our own session here soon.
Sounds good, man.
Okay. Have a good day.
Okay. Cheers.
Goodbye. Bye.
Oh, you know what? There we go. All right. So there you go. There's the pitter patter about electrical options. So if you're just tuning into the show now, this is the Art Renovation Live. We're talking about basement development tips, right? So we're going to move on now to HVAC. And I can see that we had a claimed is lurking in the background here somewhere. I'm going to try to pull him into the call because I want to talk with them a little bit about some of the HVAC considerations, because like electrical, there's some important things to consider on the HVAC side of things. Kevin Lackey.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, great, man. Good to have you back on the show.
Good to be here. Good to see you.
All right. So HVAC, I kind of just pulling you in out of nowhere here. So we haven't really talked about this yet, but you mentioned earlier in our text that there's some new permit requirements from the city. And why don't we talk a bit about that? While you're doing that, I'm going to pull up some appropriate photos here.
Great. Sounds good. So, you know, it's a tough time for everybody out there in terms of adjusting and pivoting every week. And we're pivoting constantly here. And doing a dance with the city and making sure that the permitting requirements and inspection requirements that are changing and being evolved by the city are kind of kept up to date. So what we're finding these days as it relates to basement developments is that when there's a permit taken out for basement development, whether it's just doing a bedroom addition or anything like that, the city wants to make sure that basement space, anything that's going to have a human spending time in it, is we're doing a full heat loss calculation room by room, which means that essentially at the end of the day, they're making sure that when you're closing in a space like that, that you have the appropriate return air grills in place and ventilation, and same for the heat. And certainly you've seen it bunch of times. I've seen it thousands of times in basement developments. It's always crazy when I go into an older, very extravagant basement development and nothing has been done. So there's no additions added to the supply side. The return air vents are on the ceiling where you don't want them. You want those return air vents on the floor so that it drags that air down instead of staying at ceiling level. And that's the big thing, is that it requires a lot of time. It's quite a detailed heat loss report that we now have to essentially supply the city prior to them issuing us a permit for that work. And that includes just basically finishing that basement off in terms of that space. And it's just something to do. And because the city is now pivoting with their own inspection rules in terms of their ability to do things remotely and protect their people through this crisis and whatnot, that has a lot to do with it as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it can. It's one of those things where, you know, I guess on the permitting side of things, we want to make sure that we're always doing our work in a compliant manner, but it's really tough when the target is constantly moving. But I understand they're trying to make it, you know, the best end result for the homeowner. So I support that, but it can be challenging. Sure. So you have to make sure your contractor is in the know. So if you're your own general contract and you're hiring sub trades, you need to make sure you're hiring some qualified trades. If you're relying on your GC, you better make sure they know what's going on so you don't get stuck later. You know, with some bad news. So in this image I'm showing here, up behind my head, of course, is the cold air return, which is pretty common. You'll find it up in the ceiling, in older basements or undeveloped spaces. So make sure your contractor is talking to you about where we're going to move those two down at floor level and that they're going to be in every room that's considered an occupied space. And that, like, what's the function of moving the cold air returns down there, Kevin?
Right. Well, I guess backing up just a little bit there, when a house is built and a basement is raw and not finished, those ventilation systems that are put in there, they're not meant for a basement that is going to be used and enjoyed and heated properly. They're just there so the mechanical system can keep things adequately warm downstairs so things don't freeze and the floor temperature upstairs is going to be reasonable. Right. So, and that's something that I think that a lot of times is misunderstood. People think that, well, those things are there. That means that they must be there for a reason. But they were only there for a reason at the time and not before it's been developed. And so the reason that you want those things down on the ground level is the best place to have basement registers, really surprisingly, is on the roof. You don't want to bring those down the walls and have them shooting out down low. It is to keep them up in the right locations, the right size, and up high. But you want those return air vents down to promote and encourage that air that's coming out of ceiling level to push down where we enjoy living, especially when you're sitting down, and create that airflow that's going to heat the space and not just the ceiling above your head.
Absolutely. Makes good sense. So this picture I keep pulling up, there's a few things about it that I like and very much dislike. So it's great that the frost walls were done and this house got spray foam, but I keep looking at this, the ducting. So the way that this original, I'm not going to name the builder, but this was a shocker of a build by a reputable company.
Okay.
But one thing that they did was take the path of least resistance for all of their ductwork. So this ductwork runs at an angle across what's supposed to be a bedroom.
Okay.
And what this does now is it results in a very low ceiling height in that bedroom. What if they would have run that ducting on the perimeter or moved it more to the inside of the room and follow the room perimeter? Yes, the ducting costs would have been higher. You'd pay your tin basher a bit more, all that kind of stuff, but you would have had a way better finished ceiling. And I guess it's something that, like, how often do you see this where there's no thought put into the layout for some of the HVAC other than we need to heat point B upstairs? How can we get that trunk there as efficiently as possible?
Right. Well, I'd say 99.5% or higher, there's never any thought whatsoever into basement development as it pertains to the original HVAC installation. Right. So architecturally and whatnot, it's more common than ever to have those furnace rooms and whatnot in one corner of the house. And, you know, back in the days where there were mid-efficiency furnaces, say 30 years ago and older, it was more commonplace to have them in the middle of the house. And the reason for that is it was efficient. You had even heat distribution, starts off in the middle. Architecturally, though, when you're building a basement out and whatnot, it's not very practical. So, you know, pushing those furnace rooms to the corners of the outside wall has created some of these issues where you have to get the ductwork still from point A to point B. Generally speaking, best practice and what we would like to see in terms of making a renovation a possibility without, you know, killing the bank, is to have that main ductwork follow the main beam in a home. So there's virtually, you know, almost always there's going to be a main beam running the length of the basement somewhere. So having your big distribution ducts finding their way to that and then following that beam, you have to have a drop ceiling in those areas anyway. So, you know, with basement developments, it's amazing how wonderful you know, you guys do your basement developments, I almost feel like, you know, living in a basement suite sometimes, your guys' basement suites are so nice. But, you know, you really would have to give thought to that when you're actually building the house and designing the basement at the same time to really do that. And as you know, we've done projects where we've replaced all the ductwork. You can replace it with ductwork that is shallower and wider. So you still have to have the same volume of air, and you can achieve that by going shallower, but you also have to go wider. Yeah. And it's surprising. You know, we've talked about this on many sites over the years, but moving a furnace just 1 foot or even 6 inches, it's a fairly costly thing to do. It sounds quite simple, but now you've got to disconnect everything, and it's a surprising amount of work to move all of the different things associated with it just by 6 inches. So a lot of times.
I wonder, maybe his phone got a phone call or something. Let's see if he makes it back in. Oh, there you go. Yeah, absolutely. And we have done a few jobs now where we had like very tall clients. Oh, you're back.
Yeah, right.
And we've raised those. There you go. So there's been a few jobs we've done where we have raised the head clearance on bulkheads by replacing the ductwork. And again, it's just having a good plan from the start, right? So people understand where you'll have a bulkhead, how much clearance you'll have. And at that point, they can opt in or out of the spend to redo the ducting to allow for more clearance. If you're 6'6", it probably makes sense. If you're 5'6", like me, you don't care. Like it's not a big deal, right? But you need to give it some thought. So anyhow, thanks a lot, Kevin, for coming on the show. I appreciate you coming in here out of the blue. And
thanks as always
for sharing your knowledge.
You're welcome.
All right. Talk to you soon.
All right. Good to see you. Okay. Take care. Bye-bye.
All right. Well, there you go. So HVAC, there's stuff to consider there too that's really important. It can have a major impact upon how your basement finishes and functions, and whether you're ducking under a bulkhead constantly. Anyhow, if you're just tuning into the show, this is the Art of Renovation Live, and this show is all about basement renovation tips. So we're going to move on now into plumbing considerations. So for your plumbing, if you have an older home and you're renovating the basement, you're going to want to make sure, first off, that all your hose bibs get checked. What's a hose bib, you ask? It is your exterior faucets. And usually in older homes, you did not have a frost-free hose bib. And those are tend to be prone to bursting and freezing temperatures, which we happen to live in most of our years. So get that checked out quickly. There's a few options at this stage with your plumbing before we start wrapping everything up. And a few of those would be things like, bear with me, I'm looking for some photos here to support this, but a manifold system. So if you're in an older house, you likely are going to have basically just a whole bunch of water lines teed off a main that will tee off along the way to different bathrooms and fixtures. And what you end up with then is when someone's having a shower in one bathroom and someone flushes the toilet in another one, you get a drop in water pressure or a big draw on the hot water, which then you get a cold burst in the shower, or vice versa. So one option is to put in a manifold system. What that does is create evenly distributed water lines, even water pressure, and consistent supply to each fixture. So does it cost more than the previous option? Absolutely it does. I can't imagine many people will do it the other way anymore, but it's something that you definitely need to be aware of, and you need to plan out in advance so that you get not just the best finished basement you can, but, you know, before you finish that basement ceiling, could be your last chance to address the water lines in your home. And if you have poly B in your house, this would also be a great time to replace that poly B plumbing, which is known to be flawed and can fail. So another consideration would be a recirc line, which basically what it does is you run hot water in a recirculating line constantly. So there's always hot water close nearby and ready for any fixture you turn on. So you don't get stuck waiting 30 seconds for your water to get hot in that upstairs, or main floor bathroom or tap, whatever it is. Right. So those are good consideration. Back to your original floor plan in your basement. So depending on what your floor plan entails as far as your layout, you might need to do something like this, right? So in this particular basement, we are reconfiguring bathrooms, laundry room. We moved the furnace, everything. It was a major reconfiguration of the space, which involved demoing a ton of concrete and doing a whole bunch of rough-in plumbing changes in order to facilitate the new layout. So when you get the floor plan done, you want to make sure that everything's laid out. If you don't want to move your rough plumbing, we have to make sure we then design that bathroom to sit where your existing plumbing is. And now that I say that, I realize that I did not do a very good job promoting our giveaway item today. I'm sorry. All right. I'll interrupt the plumbing considerations for a sec here. The giveaway item this week is we will do contract renovation. We'll supply a free basement floor plan. We'll come out, we'll do a site measure, get all the as-built information, and we'll do a layout for you for your basement renovation or development. It does not include the interior design services or engineering or HVAC requirements and schematics, but you will get a floor plan from us. It's worth about $1,000. To qualify for the giveaway, you have to answer a relatively easy question, or maybe it's not easy. Do you need a development permit to renovate or develop your basement? We started the show with permits. So the answer was given earlier. If you're not too sure, just look back through the comments, enter your answer into the comments, and you'll be entered into the draw. Unfortunately, this is not transferable. So if you're here and you win it, awesome. You got a floor plan. We'll come and make it for you. You want to give it to your neighbor, that's not going to fly. So sorry about that. Anyhow, moving back on into plumbing. So one thing to consider now, if you are reconfiguring the basement and we're breaking open floors, well, it's also be a good time to address your backwater valve. If you don't have one, now's the time to put one in. And what a backwater valve is, it basically keeps the city side of the sewer from coming back into your house ever. So it's a one-way valve that prevents sewer backup. So to do that, we have to open up the floor as well to facilitate that install. So it's kind of one of those things to consider where we're going to put it. Usually it's right where that sewer line enters or exits the home, but that's a consideration for sure. And then after the groundwork's done, then we obviously get our inspections completed. What else can we talk about here in the plumbing world? Tankless hot water heaters, those are also an option. It's not a cheap option. It certainly is an upgrade if you ever need to replace your hot water tank. But it gives you that hot water on demand as well, and you don't ever run out of hot water. So it might be worth the extra cost to you. That's obviously for you to decide. But I believe my job is to provide you with all your options so you can opt in or out and not find out later that there is an option available to you that you would have said yes to, and now it's cost prohibitive to go back, or just very annoying and frustrating to go back later and do it standalone. So on the plumbing side of things, I think aside from all the roughing considerations, I would say that, there's the plumbing trim consideration. So how are you going to finish your bathroom? What fixtures are you going to use? Are you going to have an acrylic tub shower? Is it fiberglass? Surround, are you going to have a nice acrylic tub with a tiled tub surround? Those are choices you have to make early so that we can execute as per the design. Now, the cost will vary as well. And one of the questions too is, if you have a tub shower, are you going to have a glass shower door, or are you going to have a shower curtain? Obviously, adding a glass shower door is going to increase the cost significantly. So you want to consider that up front and decide if that works for you, or if you've got a budget that you're trying to adhere to that might limit what you can do with your finished space. So I'm a big fan of the glass shower doors. They keep the water in where they need to be. They're easy to clean, all these different things. In your shower, your tub shower, do you want any handhelds? Do you want body sprays? All these kind of things you need to know before you get to finishing so that you can rough in the appropriate mixer valves or whatever you need to control those options. And fixture costs on the plumbing side will really vary. Like a bathtub could be $350 for an inexpensive bathtub. Your bathtub could be a few thousand dollars for a great high-end freestanding bathtub. So, we've seen $10,000 bathtubs go into our projects before, and that's totally up to the homeowner to decide if that's the way they want to go. But you need to know what it is you're spending your money on, whether it's going to, satisfy you in the long run. We're going to jump along now into some flooring options. I know that we had, I noticed earlier that Lauren Hunt was in here. I was going to check. Oh, she's around still. All right. So let's talk a bit about flooring, because when we get into you're putting your floors down, there's some options first. So before I get into that, if you're just tuning in now, this is the Art of Renovation Live, and today's show is about basement renovation tips. So we're going to talk now about flooring options. And one of the first things I want to talk a bit about is how you finish your floor, and do you put a raised subfloor down first, and why you would put that down. So let me just, I'm going to go and find Lauren and see if she can join the call, because she's got a few things I'm sure she could add here. So if you don't know Lauren, Lauren works at BFC, Builder Floor Center. She knows a ton about flooring. There she is.
Hi.
Hey, Lauren, thanks for coming
on. Can you hear me?
You betcha.
Awesome.
So I just raised the question about, we're getting into flooring now, and the raised subfloor. Now, yeah. I'm a big fan of the raised subfloor because of what it does for your home and, you know, the temperature, the softness of the floor. But I'd like to hear your take on them, because I know it has an impact on what you can put down. And there's some floor products that actually do provide some level of built-in insulation as well. So I'll let you chat about that while I look for some nice pictures to show in the background.
Yeah, I mean, 10 years ago when I got into this industry, the dry core, as you can see in that photo, that was all the rage, because people were moving away from carpeting and wanting to put wood surface in their basement. So that gave them the opportunity to raise the floor up off the ground, the concrete that typically you'd see moisture. It will protect your flooring, that if you ever had concrete moisture or just flooding in general, it'll keep that flooring from getting wet first. So really cool option, definitely for the warmth, the comfort, quiet, great for basement suites because it does absorb impact and sound. But what we're seeing now is a shift towards the vinyl plank, and that already has acoustic and warming properties to the product as is. So the great thing about the dry core still is it does have a place in the market for those basement suites or like older homes where you're renovating and it's still very cold. Really, really cool option still. But for those budgets that maybe don't allow for the additional raised floor, but there's still moisture concerns, that's where the vinyl plank just takes the cake, because it already has all those features all in one. So you can actually do the two together, or you can do the vinyl plank separately.
Yeah, I got some samples here. I just want to show quickly.
Yeah.
Vinyl plank. So this is a thin, inexpensive vinyl plank product. It's actually a decent product, but this is just, you know, basically, I don't know if it's a glue down or not, this particular one, but other options, you get into a rigid core, but this one you can see we've got the foam back. So
yeah,
that's going to really help with some insulation value and softening the floor. We have other options here where we've got a cork back, right? So
yes,
the product options are, like, as far as LVP, luxury vinyl plank floors go, there's a ton of options out in the marketplace now. And,
yeah,
you know, again, the raised subfloor, do you need it? Well, it depends what your goals are, right? I like the raised subfloor in general because of, you know, it'll raise the temperature in your of your floor 3 to 5 degrees. It's quite a bit softer. But if you're putting a home gym in there, you can't have your big weight set on top of a raised subfloor like that. That's going to flex and whatnot. So there's some things to consider about that too. But what do you see going down on basement floors most often now on concrete?
Yeah, I would say probably this guy here, which is like what you showed, but instead of cork in the back, it's a click format. So 5 mil overall thickness, and you can compare it to my finger.
Yeah,
that's a good comparison, but it has foam in the back of it instead. So the foam is doing the exact same thing as the cork. It's insulation, it's warmth. It's just more cost effective. So you'll see different thicknesses in the vinyl plank from a flooring perspective. The big one that we pay attention to is the wear layer on the surface, to just understand what kind of durability, scratch resistance you're going to get out of the flooring. And then the thickness, of course, in a renovation setting, if you're removing existing flooring and putting in new flooring, sometimes that hardier floor helps with all the fussy things. Mm-hmm. But really, at the end of the day, if the wear layers are the same and it's made out of the same stuff, it's going to perform the same for you. So I don't necessarily focus too much on the thickness of it, but that does play a factor in certain changing of floorings. And then like what you talked about with the plumbing and the concrete and the leveling issues, the hardier and the thicker, the more dense that vinyl plank is, the less fussy it's going to be on top of all of those concrete issues or subfloor issues that you might have. So,
absolutely. And I would say that, like, if you're renovating your basement, it was previously developed and you're pulling up some old carpet or whatever it is, you should be counting on having some sort of floor leveling budget, because there'll be some deficiency in that concrete floor, especially if it's from an older home. But even in new homes, you know, often you don't really feel it until you start to do the install. You get a laser out. So we always try to put in an allowance for some floor leveling, because generally it comes up.
Yeah.
Another, I guess, aspect of finishing the flooring in the basement becomes, how do you finish your stairs? So a lot of people are going hard surface on the basement floor now with a vinyl plank, with a foam back, whatever it might be. And we can do that on stairs, but a hard surface finish on a stairs is the most expensive way to finish the stairs, because it's a ton of labor that goes into it. So in this specific set of stairs here, we've got an MDF stringer and riser capping, and then we have hardwood on the tread and on the top of the stringer. Looks really sharp, but I know there's a few thousand dollars in those stairs, right?
Yeah.
Another option that we do often, which we like, is a version of this, where you have a LVP floor in your basement, you have a carpeted tread, so the surface you step on, and a carpeted stringer, which is the most expensive part to clad because of all the shape and notching around the stairs. And then we put the matching LVP or hard floor surface on the riser of the stair. So it's a nice way to finish it, but you know, it helps bring the cost down, but gives it that nicely finished look. What are your thoughts on stairs? What are your most common products you're putting on them, and what do you see out there in the world now?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, everything you just said. Oftentimes we want picture number one, but then when you break it down into the costs, it does add up in a hurry. And even though the material you're using for the vinyl is less expensive traditionally than some of your hardwoods, it's the labor that gets you, whether it's a plank, laminate, hardwood, or tile. It's very time consuming and labor intense for the installers, whereas carpet's a much faster install. So the carpet vinyl plank stairs blended together is a really great compromise for the budget, but also still getting the same or a similar look that's going to tie in the two types of floor. And carpet for families is, you know, quieter, a little softer for the kids going up and down to basements. And if you've got carpet on the basement, plank on the main level, or vice versa, it blends the two floors together. So I actually really like the carpet and plank mix, because it's really cost effective and kind of achieves the same purpose or goal at the end of it. It's great.
I guess it depends on how you plan to use the space too, right? I mean, I like carpet in the basement because it's soft, it's warm. My kids play down there. I can go down there and roll around with them too. And it's nice, right? Hard surface is easy to clean though. I prefer the look, but depends on you and how you're going to use it.
Yep.
Anyhow, thanks so much, Lauren, for jumping on the show. I appreciate it. Great to see you.
Thanks for having me. Yeah, it was great. Anytime. Thanks, Paul.
All right. Thanks. Bye-bye. All right. Well, there you go. So there's a lot more we can talk about in basements. I've got about 12 minutes left here. I should talk about the giveaway item again, because I've done a fairly poor job promoting it today. And it's a good one if you need a basement developed or renovated. So we're giving away a free floor plan. So we'll come out to your house. We'll do the site measure. We'll work with you to design a layout that makes good sense for you and your home. It's worth about $1,000. It does not include interior design services. It does not include engineering or all the mechanical and infrastructure drawings, but it does include the floor plan. So to qualify, you need to answer the question, do you need a development permit in order to renovate your basement? Just answer in the comments. You'll be qualified for the draw, which we'll give away at the end of the show. I'm sorry, but the prize is not transferable. So if you win it, you need to use it. You can't give it to your cousin. Anyhow, let's talk about windows for a second, because in the end, they have to be code compliant when you do the basement development, which means egress compliant. And if you're just tuning into the show now, this is the Art of Renovation Live, and we're talking about basement renovation tips. And specifically for windows at this point. So this one shows a non-code compliant, non-egress compliant window. That's what was in the basement. If it wasn't in a bedroom, it doesn't need to be egress compliant. So this one's not in a bedroom. In just down the hall from there, we put in this window, which used to have a small one. And we could have put what's called a hopper window in. And a hopper window is basically it's the smallest possible window that could meet egress code, which means it's the smallest possible window you can escape through. The problem with a hopper window, which is this, is it opens from the bottom inwards and up, which poses some challenges for how user-friendly that window can be. So they're difficult. They are basically, they lock in the open position straight up or halfway down. But if something ever happens, this thing falls on your head. They aren't very nice to use, but they're very much utilitarian in nature as far as giving you the best chance of putting in an egress compliant window without having to cut open your foundation. To do what we did here, we had a big foundation cut to do. We had to increase the size of the window well. We had to tie back into the weeping tile. So it's something to consider within your renovation of your basement or your basement development. Are your current windows, wherever there's a bedroom, are they egress compliant? And this takes a site measure to confirm that. Your window well, code on window wells has changed a bit too. So they have to have a certain projection off the wall to allow for enough room to crawl out that window and up and out to grade level. So in any case, there you go. So what else can we talk about here? I guess into finishing, and I'll just start showing you, we got 10 minutes left. Let's look at some pretty stuff together and we'll talk a bit about each of these options and what we like about them. So here's an option for a door in the basement. This is actually a reclaimed wood barn door that we use. We've got this. This is out of Marathorpe. The door is about 100 years old. Looks great. It adds a fair bit of character to the space. It's a beautiful piece, and those are not expensive upgrades, but I think, in my opinion, it's totally worth it. Let's see here. Here we have a basement where we did an electric fireplace, and those are a great option too, because electric fireplace, they're relatively inexpensive, you don't need the venting like you would or a gas line like you would for a gas fireplace, right? So in this instance, we build the fireplace chase. Like we discussed earlier in the electrical section of the show, we put in the raceways, so we have the pipe in place for recessed wires and whatnot after you mount your TV. In this particular image, we've done some IKEA base cabinets, some custom wall cabinets, and we upgraded the bedroom door to have lamy glass or French doors in them, and it allows some natural light to move around and creates a nice finished space. So it's a nice way to class up a space a little bit, and it's not terribly expensive as far as accomplishing that goes. Here's another nice basement we finished. This is in a custom home that we built, and you can see the large basement windows, nice open concept. We have a nice bar there. One thing to note might also be there's like the glass and metal railings, which is obviously an upgrade, but it's a really nice way to, not impede line of sight, and it allows light to flow around, and it's a nice little touch for finishing a space. You can see here the LED pot lighting grid or LED panel lights. It really helps to light the space. In that bar, there is under cabinet lighting, which again creates some ambient light, and it looks really nice. So something to consider. Here's an interesting one we did. We had a space here. I'm going to try to find a wide angle for you here first before I show you that one. So here's this basement. We had this space underneath the stairs coming down to the basement, and they wanted to do something interesting with that. So we built them a little bar area under the stairs, and then we added a little library area in the corner. So, here's how we built the bar. Again, some under cabinet or under shelf lighting. This is all made with IKEA products. We use a lot of custom cabinets as well, but in this particular job, the configuration of the IKEA cabinets worked just fine, saved the client some money. And then we built a little library area again, modifying some IKEA components, incorporating some tiles, some glass, and some custom countertop. Here's a nice multi-use space that we did out of a basement. And it was in a skinny home, so it had a narrow basement. But in the end, we made a multi-use space. So you've got a theater area. You have a bedroom with a Murphy bed. Well, a bedroom, a bed area with the Murphy bed. And then you also have, when the Murphy bed's up, you've got the gym area there as well. So you can really get that games room, the theater room, the gym and the bedroom kind of in one space if you plan it well. Here's a part of a secondary suite we did. Again, we added the linear electric fireplace, some recessed shelving, just little touches that you can do to really make a space pop out. this bedroom, we increased the window size significantly to get lots of natural light into the bedroom. This is the same project. We did a nice cork floor, you know, lots of good LED lighting. And then we get into other options for basements. Here we did a kitchenette in the basement. It's not a secondary suite. It was one of those instances where the client was able to sign off with the city acknowledging this is not going to be used as a secondary suite. So they got kind of a little cooking area. And there's no range in this one, which is the range can be the deal breaker. If you have a range, it's considered more of a kitchen. This one was more of just a wet bar. And then we did a couple of neat details, custom bookshelf, things like that. Yeah, so there's lots of different ways and options within finishing a basement. I think the key, in my opinion, is to do it right from the start. You need a good plan. You need a great design. You need to make sure you deal with those really important infrastructure items like your framing, your insulation, your electrical, your HVAC considerations. All those things need to be well planned to get a great finish at the end of a job. We're all about making beautiful spaces, but it has to be well built. And to do that, you need to spend a bit more than what meets code minimum. And so what we specialize in is doing a great job from design, infrastructure, all those considerations through to the finishing details. And that's something that any good contractor will consider, right? So on average, our basements are probably somewhere in that $70 a square foot range. You know, a secondary suite development will be somewhere in the $100 a square foot range, but there's a lot of things that will impact that price, options that you can opt in or out of, whether you want the heated floor tile, whether you want the under cabinet lighting, whether you want the raised subfloor, whether you want to spray foam the rim joist, whether you want LED panel light grid or just one light in the middle of the room, whether you want quartz countertops or you're happy with just the acrylic top from IKEA. Those are all the things that will drive the bottom line price. And really that's, you'll be in the driver's seat as far as what you put in. It's just up to me and any good contractor to let you know what your options are. So I'm going to give a shout out to Alyssa out there. It's 157. If we've got a winner, you might as well send it over. Well, the show's going to wrap up here in a few minutes. And yeah, we'll see who the winner was for the free floor plan. Sorry I did such a bad job promoting it today, but this hour has flown by. I wasn't sure what to expect with me doing this solo, but I'm glad I had a few guests come in to help out with the conversation. And so the giveaway item this week was a free floor plan design from Contact Renovation, the custom homes, and worth about $1,000. We'll come to site, we'll do a site measure, work with you to design a space that works for you as far as the layout is concerned. It does not include interior design, engineering, all that stuff. And it's for you. If you win it today, fantastic. We'll do it for you. Not transferable. I'm sorry to hit you with the fine print, but there is just too many components here that could go sideways if we don't clarify some of it. So, so I'm just going to pull up here my information, I guess. So, if you have any questions about a potential basement renovation or development, please reach out. We're happy to help you out and make sure you start off on the right foot. We have a winner. I've just been told that Tasha Main, you're the winner. I'll reach out to you after the show here and we'll get you set up with the process to get that basement design going. But yeah, congratulations. So yeah, in the end, if you want to renovate your basement, there's a lot to consider. Make sure you're presented with your options by your contractor. If you're taking it on yourself, you should do some research. I'm happy to help you out. Give us a call, book a time to chat with me, and I'll give you all the kind of ins and outs about things to plan and expect and prepare for in your basement renovation project. It's 159. Instagram's going to kick me off, Reddit too, so I'll say goodbye now. This is the Art of Renovation Live. I'm your host, Paul Foster from Contact Renovation and Custom Homes. We're back in a couple of weeks and we'll get to another live show. If you want more tips, check out our YouTube channel. All our videos are posted there. And yeah, great. Thanks for joining. Have a great day.